Hi there, physics fans old and new. In case you haven't noticed, this series has turned its attention to gravity. Like the microcosm, gravity is often misunderstood by the public in many circumstances, perhaps most notably when dealing with black holes. Misunderstandings are opportunities, so black holes are the topic of the next couple of episodes of Subatomic Stories. Black holes are places with gravity that is so strong that they bend space and time, and even the mind. The first two are bad enough, but bending the mind leads to misconceptions. So let's spend this episode learning about black holes and some of the common ones. Black holes are locations in the universe where so much mass is concentrated in such a small space that gravity is so strong that not even light can escape. They are most commonly created by the death of an ultramassive star that used up all of its fuel and then exploded, leaving a black hole in its wake. Astronomers are still working out the rules that govern how big black holes can be if they're made this way. The smallest one found so far has a mass of 3.8 times the mass of the Sun, and the biggest one seemed to be maybe 30 times the mass of the Sun or so. There are another class of black holes called supermassive black holes, but those are a different thing, and they'll have to wait for a future episode. So, the first misconception about black holes is that they are some sort of ravenous monsters that reach out and grab surrounding matter. That doesn't happen. At reasonable distances, black holes are no different than stars of the same mass. If it were possible to make a black hole with the mass of our Sun, and we replace the Sun with it, the planets would notice. Well, you know, except for that whole "it got dark" thing. No, black holes and stars are different simply because you can get closer to them. The force of gravity changes as a function of distance from a massive object. That's true in general. Since a hypothetical black hole with the mass of the Sun is about 3.5 miles wide, or about 6 kilometers, you can get really very close to it. And it's that strong gravity near the surface that's hard to escape. Speaking of size, that's another thing that is confusing to some people. The most useful measurement of the size of a black hole is what's called the Schwarzschild radius, named after Karl Schwarzschild, who calculated the size of a black hole while fighting on the Russian front in World War I. Between artillery barrages and bayonet charges, he used Einstein's equations to figure out the size of a non-rotating black hole. That's dedication to physics. The Schwarzschild radius is the distance from the center of a non-rotating black hole where gravity becomes so strong that not even light can escape. Sometimes people call it the event horizon. For non-rotating black holes, well, they're the same thing. The Schwarzschild radius for an object with the mass of our Sun is about 3 kilometers. For a mass equivalent to the Earth, it's just 9 millimeters. And for a smallish adult-sized human, it's about 1/10 of a trillionth the size of a proton. For me, it's a bit bigger, but hey, I'm working on it. There's another size that is often mentioned when people talk about black holes. When a black hole is formed, the matter that made up the stars crushed down to a tiny size. According to the equations of general relativity, that tiny size is literally zero size. It's what's called a singularity. Now, the idea of an object having zero size seems unreasonable to most people, and that intuition turns out to be sensible. In spite of the frequently repeated claim that a singularity lies at the center of a black hole, no scientist takes it seriously. A singularity just means that the equations have been pushed beyond the realm of the physical. Singularities are math things, not physics things. I don't want you to come away with the idea that the scientific community doesn't know what it's talking about. It's certainly true that the matter that makes up a black hole is crushed to a very small size. But the claim that it's zero size is a consequence of general relativity, which we know fails in the world of the super small. For that, we need a theory of quantum gravity, which we don't have yet. We talked about quantum gravity in the last episode. Because we don't have a theory of quantum gravity, we don't know exactly what the center of a black hole is, but we can be pretty certain that it's not a literal mathematical singularity. Of course, since we can't escape a black hole, it's going to be hard to ever make direct measurements of what the center of a black hole really looks like. You know, there's an awful lot to say about black holes. I think I'll stop here and continue talking about black holes for the next episode or two. I expect that we'll have some spectacular questions and answers. Speaking of questions, let's see what questions the episode on quantum gravity has inspired. Learning about the one force not yet explained at the quantum level has certainly generated some very serious questions. I hope I get an answer with the appropriate gravity. I cracked myself up. Okay, I'm getting serious now. Let's see what questions our viewers have for me. Michael Blacktree asks that if gravitons exist, if they're the force-carrying particle for space-time, and if that means that space-time is an energy field. Hi, Michael. The answer to your question is hard to give definitively. What we know is that general relativity says that the force of gravity can be explained as the bending of space and time. We also know that, if it exists, that the graviton is the quantum carrier of gravity. That's simply a definition. In order for the graviton to be, as you said, the force-carrying particle of space-time, the connection between energy and matter, space and time, would have to persist at the quantum level. Without a theory of quantum gravity, I think that's a step too far. It may be that quantum gravity shows that the connection between the distribution of energy and space-time isn't causal, but rather arises from a deeper principle that governs both. And then there are theories of gravity which says that it emerges from a quantum entanglement encoded in a two-dimensional holographic representation of the universe. And yes, you should be forgiven if that sounds just like a bunch of gobbledygook. It isn't. It's at least a semi-respectable theory. The bottom line is that it's probably premature to answer your question. The answer to your second question is easier. According to general relativity, there is a one-to-one correspondence between energy and space-time. So, at least in that theory, yes. Luis Lopez congratulates me for simply mentioning the possibility that relativity can be modified. Hi, Luis. This is a sticky point. It boils down to the fact that there are a lot of science enthusiasts who are completely confident that they found some fatal flaw in either special or general relativity. While I admire their enthusiasm, many of them, indeed most of them, don't understand relativity well enough to have a substantive criticism. The criticisms are often philosophical, or when they include equations, they use special case equations for general cases. Or, and this is a common situation, they don't know all of the tests to which relativity has been subjected and successfully passed. In short, many of these critics simply haven't mastered the subject well enough, but they don't realize it, and many become quite upset if you point any of those things out. However, among the professional science community, we always remain open to changes of accepted theories. That's how science works. There's never a rigid insistence that any theory cannot be questioned. After all, I've said that scientists are well aware that general relativity fails in the quantum realm, and there are a number of modifications of relativity that are supposed to solve the dark matter mystery. But with that said, relativity has passed many very stringent tests. We know where it works and where it doesn't. And if anyone has a new theory that they claim is better than either form of relativity, they need to expect to be confronted with a huge body of knowledge and a daunting gauntlet of data that relativity has successfully survived. Overthrowing relativity is possible, just difficult. Emmett O'Brien asks if there was a hope that the LHC would produce evidence of a graviton. Hi, Emmett. The answer to your question is yes and no. There was zero chance that the LHC would produce a classical graviton. Zero. However, there was a possibility of finding a graviton if there exist extra dimensions of space that gravity can enter, but the other forces can't. These extra dimensions would explain the relative weakness of gravity. These extra dimensions would be small, smaller than a millionth of a meter, probably much smaller than that. Furthermore, they are cyclical, like the surface of a sphere. And if we use the LHC data to study objects the size of these extra dimensions, the gravity will suddenly become strong. Furthermore, these gravitons would be massless, but they could be trapped in these small dimensions, which would mean that they have energy, but no momentum. That means, according to us big beings, they would appear to have mass. I made a long-form video on extra dimensions, which explains this all in more detail. The link is in the description. It's a very cool idea. Divyansh Vishwakarma says that we know that the smallest possible length is the Planck length, and doesn't that give some proof that loop quantum gravity is real? Hi, Divyansh. That's a good question. The answer is no, but it's a reasonable question to ask. In fact, I think I'm going to issue an IOU for this one, since the Planck length is frequently badly misunderstood. You're going to have to wait for a couple of episodes while I deal with black holes, but I'll get back to it. Bjarni Voller asks about the origins of the Fermilab logo. Well, there's a long history, and I put a URL in the description that explains it all. But basically, it's an artistic combination of the two most important magnets in a particle accelerator, the dipole and the quadrupole. Dipoles bend the path of particle beams, and quadrupoles focus them. In an optical analogy, dipoles are prisms and quadrupoles are lenses. Take the two plates of a dipole and combine them with the four bent plates of a quadrupole, and voila, one Fermilab logo. Beautiful, isn't it? Skjørg Olufsen points out a difference between particle physicists and cosmologists regarding the observation of dark matter. I suppose it's true. But even cosmologists admit that dark matter isn't a complete lock. Well, honest ones, anyway. Now, there are tons of lines of astronomical evidence that dark matter is real. Galaxies rotate too quickly. Clusters of galaxies should tear themselves apart. The images of distant galaxies are distorted. All of these are examples of observations that clearly point that we're missing something, and that something is often called dark matter. But dark matter hasn't been directly observed. We haven't directly detected a dark matter particle in the wild, so to speak. Hints of indirect observation of dark matter in the center of galaxies appear and then are explained by more ordinary phenomena. Particle accelerators try to make dark matter and fail. If we're honest, all we know is that there are astronomical mysteries that we need to explain. Dark matter probably is real. I think it's probably real. But it would be hasty to say that the story is over. Guillermo Matos Passerini asks me where I get my haircuts. Hi, Guillermo. It's easy. Physicists are masters of energy, space, and time. You think that we let such mundane concerns as haircuts get in our way? My hair wouldn't dare cross me. Oh, yeah. And clippers work wonders. Can't go wrong with clippers. Okay, so that's all the time we have for questions. You know the drill. Like, subscribe, and share. Let's spread the physics love far and wide because, well, you know, even at home, physics is everything.